This is not an iceberg video, but it's still a collection of random Donkey Kong trivia. So if you want to skip the long-winded explanation and get right to the fun facts and stuff, check the timestamps in the description. Now I know most of the people who are subscribed to me know me as the Mario 64 Iceberg Guy, also known as the guy who started an influx of iceberg videos on YouTube, and also the guy who promised to do more iceberg videos in the future. Well, when looking for potential topics, a friend of mine suggested Donkey Kong Country. This eventually spiraled into us sharing a lot of random miscellaneous trivia back and forth, a lot of which wasn't covered in any existing iceberg. So eventually I decided that I'm gonna talk about whatever Donkey Kong trivia I find particularly interesting, and hopefully you find some of it interesting too. When talking about Donkey Kong Country games, I'm mainly focusing on the ones made by Rare. In this video specifically, I'll be focusing on DKC1. Now I'm not some purist who thinks the first three games are the only good ones, they're just the ones I know best. The Donkey Kong Country Returns games are very much worth playing, and I do have a nostalgic soft spot for Donkey Kong Jungle Beat. So sit back, relax, and join me as I take you on a journey through DKI. Okay, you know these enemies? They're called Rock Crocs, and they only appear in one level. The main challenge of this level, Stop and Go Station, revolves around activating these barrels and keeping the Rock Crocs asleep. In the North American and European version, they're completely invincible, but in the Japanese version, they're able to be killed by Donkey Kong's hand slap. This change was carried over to the Game Boy Advance port, too. Although all versions of Donkey Kong Country on the Super Nintendo were released within 8 days of each other, there are actually a lot of differences in the Japanese version. The North American and European versions are mostly the same, although the earlier North American releases contain numerous glitches that were later ironed out, but we'll get to those soon. The most obvious change when booting up the game is the title screen. The Japanese one uses the same image they got on the box art, while the version we know uses an original image. Most of the actual gameplay changes aren't nearly as drastic as being able to kill Rock Crocs, as the vast majority either involve removing enemies or adding more DK barrels. Minecart Carnage had a bunch of the broken down minecarts removed, as well as some of the Kremlings riding carts. The only instance I could find of an enemy being added instead of being taken away was an extra Crusha being added before this arrow sign in Torchlight Trouble. All in all, the Japanese version is quite a bit easier. Torchlight Trouble actually has a few other unique things about it. It's the only level that features Squawks the Parrot, whose only function in this game is to carry a light, since the level is in complete darkness. Other than Squawks being the only invincible animal buddy, he's also the reason the game had to have a minor change when Nintendo eventually re-released the game on modern consoles. In the original, every time you turn around, Squawks turns with you, and he points the light directly at the camera, causing the entire screen to go white for one frame. Not only is this really annoying, but it could also potentially trigger photosensitive epilepsy in some people, so this one frame flash was outright removed. Here's another fact related to the Japanese version. So, Donkey Kong Country is called Super Donkey Kong in Japan. The games retained their titles when ported to the Game Boy Advance, but for the Game Boy Color port of DKC1, it's called Donkey Kong 2001. It sort of makes sense since Donkey Kong Land was just called Super Donkey Kong GB in Japan. Anyway, I find the name Donkey Kong 2001 amusing, only because it reminds me of all those insane bootlegs with equally weird names, like Super Donkey Kong 99 for the Genesis. The Game Boy Color port almost feels like a bootleg, to be honest. I mean, can you blame me? One of the menu screens is literally just a screenshot of Donkey Kong 64. That seems like something straight out of a bootleg and not something you'd see in an actual retail game. Even though it's no doubt the worst official way to play Donkey Kong Country, it's still pretty impressive that they got this entire game running on the Game Boy Color of all things. Donkey Kong Land 2 was just called Donkey Kong Land in Japan, and then Donkey Kong Land 3 was called Donkey Kong GB, Dinky Kong, and Dixie Kong. It's worth noting that the third Donkey Kong Land game never came out on the original Game Boy in Japan, receiving a Game Boy Color port in the year 2000 instead. The same thing sort of happened with Wario Land 2. I guess mentioning Wario is just a reoccurring theme on my channel by now, but oddly enough, Wario was actually meant to appear in Donkey Kong Country as the villain. There was this frankly insane storyline that Rare pitched to Nintendo, where Wario steals a time machine made by Mario and wants to rule Nintendo Land with some futuristic gun. Obviously, they scrapped this entire thing as there's no references to Wario in any Donkey Kong Country game as far as I'm aware. This is a good time to talk about the themes of each game. Not in terms of story necessarily, but aesthetics and stuff. Like, okay, obviously Donkey Kong Country 2 is pirate themed. Most of the Kremlings are in pirate costumes, and a good chunk of levels take place on pirate ships and stuff. Apparently Donkey Kong Country 3 is meant to have themes of the Industrial Revolution. We'll get back to that later, but my main point here is that the first Donkey Kong Country game doesn't really have a central theme, or at least not one that was immediately obvious to me. Of course, not having a theme isn't a bad thing, and since this was a reboot of the Donkey Kong series, it made sense to play it safe. However, you've probably noticed that a few of the Kremlings are in military-style clothing, specifically Krusha and Klump. Greg Mayles, the lead designer for Donkey Kong Country, shared a bunch of concept art and documents on his Twitter, which showed a few more Kremling designs which were also military-themed but were ultimately scrapped. Greg Mayles was a designer for a few Battletoads games before DKC, so it wouldn't be too surprising if the Kremlings borrowed a few design cues from that series. All things considered though, I think the first Donkey Kong Country has more themes of industrialism, or like capitalism I guess, than the third one. Like, in DKC1 you have a whole area called Kremcroc Industries Incorporated, which is all polluted and disgusting, in stark contrast to the beautiful, natural setting of the rest of the game. You'd think that all of this would indicate that the Kremlings are invaders of DK Isle, but the temple levels have Kremling faces in the background, so they've clearly been present on the island for a long time. Speaking of Kremling statues, in another Twitter post, Greg Mayles shared a design document that had a list of characters who were meant to appear in Donkey Kong Country. Most of these characters, either enemies or Kongs, ended up making it in, but a few were either changed before the final release or cut entirely. One of these enemies was supposed to be a statue Kremling called Crumble, which was different than the stone Kremlings that actually made it in, Rockcroc, which is spelled with a K on this document. There was also a robot Kremling, Crocbot, which has a few sprites of his death animation, but they went unused. Crocbot never appeared in a later game, which is unfortunate since a robot Kremling would have fit in nicely in DKC3. Finally, for the Kremlings, there's Cloak, who did make it into DKC2. Another enemy from the second game that didn't make it into Donkey Kong Country is Puffed Up, a pufferfish enemy who actually has graphics in the ROM of Donkey Kong Country 1. His tail fins are blue instead of white like they normally are in DKC 2, and he only has his idle animation, but it's pretty cool that he exists in the game at all. Now there are a few other interesting names on this early naming sheet, like Frozone, but to me one of the most significant names is Hooter. Hope we can use this one. Thankfully, I can put away my detective cap for this one because Greg Mayles confirmed in a reply that Hooter was replaced by Squawks. This one just baffled me because you'd think an owl would make way more sense to light up a dark cave than a parrot would. The only real reason I can think of for why they cut Hooter is that they ended up reusing Squawks in the other DKC games, like having him carry you through levels, which might not have worked with an owl. But I doubt they were planning that far ahead when designing an animal buddy who only appeared in a single level in the first Donkey Kong Country game. In yet another early document shared by Greg Mayles, we see an owl as well as a bunch of other potential animal buddies. Now this document is dated August 4th, 1993, while the document with all the names is from March 8th, 1994. So it's clear that this collection of animal buddies was mostly just stuff that never got off the drawing board. Still though, it's interesting that this owl would have given you information, while Hooter would have lit up dark caves. We also have another bird who looks much closer to Squawks, and this flightless bird which is obviously similar to Espresso. This frog eventually became Winky, and this rhino became Rambi. This isn't as obvious by looking at the sheet, but when Greg tweeted this out, he confirmed that the dolphin and the shark were combined to become On Guard. The idea for this flying pig was also repurposed into an enemy in Donkey Kong Land. There's also this mole, which might have been the basis for Hard Hat, the third boss of Donkey Kong Land, but I don't know, he's just a mole. A flying pig is way more specific than just the generic mole with a hat. Same goes for this woodpecker. It could have been turned into the swoopy enemies from DKC 3, but who knows. One that I definitely know for sure is this elephant. The little caption underneath says, "Elephant that sucks things and blows things from its trunk. For example, baddies in water," which is a pretty clear-cut description of Ellie the Elephant from Donkey Kong Country 3. Okay, now for some cheat codes. Most of these are pretty well known, but they're still worth talking about. These first two codes aren't super interesting, so I'll get them out of the way first. If you highlight Erase Game and press B, A, down, B, up, down, down, Y, or Bad Buddy, it lets player 2 switch places with you at any time during co-op. It's kinda cool, but honestly pretty useless unless you really enjoy pure chaos. The other less useful code also starts off by highlighting Erase Game. Press down A R B Y, down A Y, or Darby Day to access the sound test. Now obviously this game has an amazing soundtrack, but you're watching this video on YouTube. If you wanted to listen to music from this game nowadays, your first thought probably wouldn't be to boot up the game and input a cheat code. Not to mention, if you knew about this code before this video, there's a good chance you got it off the internet anyway. Of course, if you did know this code without any help from the internet, well shit, you should probably be hosting this video instead of me. Okay, now for the more useful ones. Right as the intro starts playing, if you press down Y, down down Y, or Diddy, you'll access this room with a bunch of animal tokens, which allows you to practice all the bonus stages. You can actually use the lives you collect here within your save file, which you're normally not meant to do. To do this, you have to get a game over while you have an active partner. This means you have to specifically fall down a pit to die, since doing that will let you keep your partner, as opposed to dying to an enemy. Once you've jumped down enough pits to get a game over, press start to go back to the title screen. Then immediately enter the down Y down down Y code to access the bonus rooms. Then when you're finished collecting lives, just hit start and then select to exit with all your accumulated lives intact. You can even start back on the level you died at. Kinda cool, but it's pretty much invalidated by this next code. On the file select screen, highlight Erase Game, then hit B-A-R-R-A-L, or barrel, to get 50 lives. This last thing also has to do with obtaining a bunch of extra lives, but it's more of a glitch. It's not immediately obvious because there's no point indicator when you jump on an enemy, but just like in Mario, you'll get an extra life if you jump on enough enemies consecutively. This can be exploited in one specific place which contains an enemy that Diddy can't kill, effectively allowing him to jump on its head forever. At the beginning of Millstone Mayhem, if you lure this Crusha into place and hold left, you'll perform the glitch, racking up a ton of lives. The interesting thing about this is that Nintendo officially pointed it out on their YouTube channel when Donkey Kong Country 1 was released on the Nintendo Switch Online app. It's always cool to see them acknowledge things like this, since Nintendo usually wants to draw attention away from glitches and exploits like this. It's kind of like how they've acknowledged things like the extra lives trick in Super Mario Bros. Or the Minus World glitch in the same game. All this talk about points and lives and stuff brings up the question, have you ever wanted a points counter in Donkey Kong Country? Have you ever thought to yourself, man, I wish this game was more like Mario, what with points and a timer and all that junk? Well, you're in luck, because there does exist one version of the game with a points counter, the Donkey Kong Country Competition Kart. This was a special version of the game used at a couple Nintendo events, such as PowerFest 94, where the final two entrants had to compete for a high score. Now this wasn't just normal Donkey Kong Country, but with a score system. It was specifically made for the competition. Players had 5 minutes to make it as far as possible and rack up a high score. There were 11 levels you could play through, although it's impossible to see the last 3 levels within the 5-minute timer. The levels were Jungle Hijinks, Reptile Rumble, Ropey Rampage, Coral Capers, Winky's Walkway, Bouncy Bonanza, Orangutan Gang, Snow Barrel Blast, Slipslide Ride, Ice Age Alley, and Croctopus Chase. Anyway, since enemies in this version give 10 points when defeated, and Cranky claims you need to bounce on 8 enemies to get an extra life, I guess you only need a whopping 80 points for an extra life in this game. Or maybe it's like Mario where the score doubles with each consecutive enemy. Though who knows if the competition cart is to be trusted at all. Bananas and enemies give you a low amount of points, probably because they're everywhere. And taking out a bunch of enemies consecutively doesn't seem to multiply the points you get. Doing things like entering a bonus room or advancing to the next level grants a ton of points. Though ironically, the best way to rack up your score is to just grind for points in level 1. At the end of the 5 minutes, the game will freeze so that the judge can count the final score. The competition cart was based off of revision 1.2 of Donkey Kong Country, so let's talk about revisional differences. One of the most infamous exploits in all of Donkey Kong Country is the map warp. These three corners of the map screen in World 1 have a weird property, where if you press A, B, X, Y, or Start the same frame you land on them, you get warped to Orangutan Gang. This was removed in the 1.2 version of the game. For obvious reasons, this makes 1.0 the best version for speedrunning. Another change in the 1.2 version was removing the ability to skip the little victory animation after beating a level. The last revisional difference that I found super interesting is that, prior to 1.2, a ton of mini Nekis had no collision, meaning you could phase through them. The weird thing about this change is that it was apparently undone for the Game Boy Advance port. Well, Nintendo can make as many classified info videos as they want, but I know they're not going to talk about unused content like this. Cranky Kong has a ton of dialogue that was completely cut from the SNES version, a lot of which can still be found within the ROM. A good chunk of these lines show that Cranky was a lot more friendly to DK and Diddy, even complimenting them at times. I guess the decision to make him more, well, cranky was made later on. Different from these nicer versions of Cranky's dialogue are a bunch of level-specific tips which were also omitted for some reason. Now there are a lot of these, so I'll go over some of the more interesting ones. The TNT gives you a couple of real wall-to-wall blasts in Torchlight Trouble. Well, there are no TNT barrels in the entire stage, but this hint is obviously telling you to use them to break open a wall to find the bonus rooms. Torchlight Trouble is in the fourth world, so at this point in the game, you'd know to check pretty much every wall if there's a barrel nearby. Now this is pure speculation on my part, but this line might imply that only TNT barrels were able to open walls, and that regular barrels were probably just for throwing at enemies. I could be entirely wrong, but I think it kinda makes sense. In the final game, TNT barrels are only used to defeat otherwise unkillable enemies. This is kind of a more obscure use for TNT, since the specific enemies which can only be killed with TNT barrels only show up in certain stages, whereas bonus rooms are in almost every level. Another one of Cranky's unused lines alludes to the same thing. Let Diddy hold out the TNT in Manic Mincers. In case you didn't know, the way each of the Kongs holds barrels does impact gameplay. Donkey Kong holds barrels above his head while Diddy holds them out in front of him. This makes Diddy much better at checking for secrets, since the barrel will explode on contact with a secret wall, revealing the bonus area. Now Manic Mincers does have a TNT barrel, but it's kind of far from the bonus area, which has a normal barrel sitting right in front of it. Now what's interesting about Manic Mincers is that it actually has an early unused section that looks like a bonus room. I say it only looks like one because this isn't a separate area, it's built into the level geometry, but you can't see it since the camera doesn't pan down to it. It has these holes in the ground which apparently aren't seen in any other cave level. There aren't any objects or warps in this room, so it's completely non-functional, but cool nonetheless. Now the weird thing about these cranky tips is figuring out why they were even cut. The lines where he isn't as cranky make sense, but most of these level tips are pretty helpful. You might be thinking that they cut them to make Cranky seem even more rude to you, since giving you these tips would be pretty nice, right? The thing is though, a few of these level-specific tips did make it into the game, but only for levels in World 1. Here are all the tips for World 1. Just normal stuff like hints for bonus rooms or extra bananas, but this one stuck out to me. Go bananas in the snake pit of Reptile Rumble. Now what the hell does this mean? Well, when looking through the level maps on DKC Atlas, which is an amazing website by the way, you can use a toggle that lets you see things like bonus room entrances and hidden bananas. As we can see in the snake pit at the end of Reptile Rumble, there are three bunches of bananas. Any indicator that looks like this shows where you can find banana bunches by using Donkey Kong's hand slap. But the thing is, most of these hand slap spots have no indication that they're even there. Like yeah, this spot was hinted at by Cranky, and there are quite a few that are right in the middle of a trio of enemies, but for the vast majority, I think you'd only really find them if you painstakingly went and hand-slapped every inch of every stage. Though, I guess if I was a little kid playing this game for the first time, that's probably what I'd do. Guys, I have to admit something. I'm a Zoomer. Generation Z. While I did play Donkey Kong Country growing up, I started with the Game Boy Advance version, and only played the Super Nintendo version later. Now I did have an old cathode ray tube television when I was growing up, or CRT for short. but by the time I had access to video games, that thing was long gone. All this is to say that most of my retro game experiences have been on modern displays, be it through official means or otherwise. But old games weren't meant for these modern screens. Developers back in the 80s and 90s had to make games with these old TVs in mind. CRT TVs would slightly stretch the image horizontally, and individual pixels would end up kind of bleeding together. This is why a lot of developers made sprites that were a bit skinnier than they needed to be, and why dithering worked pretty well with a limited color palette. Take this shot of Diddy, for example. When you zoom in on the raw image, it doesn't look too good. Compare it to the CRT though, and all those loose pixels kind of get blended together, and overall it looks much better. The leaves in the background don't look as messy, and the ground looks like it has more texture to it. It looks even better against the sunset. The background of this stage looks absolutely beautiful. The horizontal lines just disappear and end up looking like a cohesive gradient. Again, take a look at the trees. Those green splotches you see on emulator look a lot more like actual shading. Darker details tend to be pretty obscured though, but that could also be due to the settings on my TV. In this walkway level, the background details are almost completely gone, aside from the lights off in the distance. I should make it clear that CRTs aren't the objective best way to play old games, and in cases like this, seeing more pixel-perfect details on an emulator is better. This is especially true for a level like Loopy Lights, where the entire challenge revolves around being able to see the actual level, made much harder on a TV that doesn't display darker colors all too well. Back to the walkway level though, the actual foreground elements look great. The metal bars above the Kongs have the illusion of depth, and the light illuminating the bars looks more pronounced. The wooden floorboards also just look really good. I find that wood in general tends to look pretty good on a CRT. Like dang, look at those barrels, dude. This is what you wanted to see. The background of the treetop levels also suffers from the same issue of losing details in darkness. But you could argue that that makes it more atmospheric. The water levels are also known for being atmospheric, but the background just looks flat out bad here. It has these ugly seams where you can clearly see the division between the top, middle, and bottom of the background image. Definitely a win for the emulators here, but again, this might just be an issue with my specific TV. There are quite literally thousands of different TVs and monitors you could play this game on, and even the way the game is plugged into the TV will give you different results. If you have an old CRT lying around and a way to play games on it, I highly recommend messing around with some of your favorites and seeing how they look. This CRT section has just been me, being a giant nerd, talking about how pixels looked before I was born, so I don't know if this will be interesting to most people or not. If you are a giant nerd like me and you want to see even more examples of this thing, I really recommend checking out CRT Pixels on Twitter. This account entirely convinced me to go out and buy one of these things, and they even have an FAQ about how to take decent pictures of CRTs. Genuinely a really great account I can never get enough of. Someday I do want to look at more games on old TVs, because it really is a lost art that I think more people should know about.
Because I believe the only true way to play
Donkey Kong Country
is on an old piece of shit like that.
Since I mentioned growing up with the GBA version, I guess now is a good time to talk about some differences between it and the original. Now, I'll be honest, there are way too many tiny changes that they made to reasonably cover, so I'll mostly be going over the bigger changes. Like, most of the little differences don't stand out too much on their own, but because there are so many, it does make the GBA version feel like a pretty different experience. The most upfront differences are the graphics and audio. Overall, it looks and sounds a lot worse than the Super Nintendo version, but that's to be expected. It does have some minor improvements, like Kong letters spinning and bonus barrels being clearly indicated, like the other games in the trilogy. There are even the little intro cards for the different types of bonus stages. The original version of DKC-1 definitely feels a bit empty compared to the other two games, so the GBA version did add a bunch of stuff to alleviate that. I will say though, I don't think that this is a detriment to the original version of DKC-1. I think that game serves as the perfect appetizer to Donkey Kong Country 2. It leaves you wanting more without feeling fed up with it. Back in the GBA version though, there are actual cutscenes at the beginning and end, as well as whenever you beat a boss, and there are more collectibles and minigames. For collectibles, you have cameras scattered throughout the game, many of which you can uncover with Donkey Kong's hand slap. Not only do you get the satisfaction of finding a collectible, but you get to see an old 3D render in all its crusty GBA glory. These are required for 101%. And for minigames, since you can now call Funky from anywhere on the map, as well as being able to save your game anywhere as well, they instead let you do a fishing minigame with Funky and a dance minigame with Candy. They're both alright, nothing special though. The biggest things the GBA version added were a few new modes for extra replay value too. First is Hero Mode, which is unlocked by beating the game with 90% completion or higher. You can only play as Diddy, wearing yellow clothes instead of red, and there are no DK barrels or checkpoints. Basically, it's like the toughest code from Donkey Kong Country 3. There's also DK Attack Mode. You pretty much just go through levels under a strict time limit and aim for a high score, kinda like another version of Donkey Kong Country I went over earlier. Although in this version you actually can play through every level, and there are bonuses all around that will increase the amount of time you can spend in the stage. Overall, it's way more robust, but then again, the DKC competition cartridge wasn't meant to be played outside of the competitions it was designed for. Now, I understand that the stages needed to be overbrightened to account for the original GBA not having a backlight, but for some reason they changed a bunch of the enemy colors with no rhyme or reason. Green critters are now purple, and a lot of the zingers also have different color palettes. Even in the original, the color of these bees is confusing. Later games just had two variants. Ones you could kill with barrels, and ones that were more or less invincible. In DKC1, though, it's weird. None of the zingers are invincible, and their color only determines their flight pattern. Yellow ones fly up and down, orange ones fly side to side, reddish-pink ones fly in a circle, and green ones fly in a parabola. Yeah, I'm glad they changed it in the later games. Overall, the GBA version is worth playing if you want something new with Donkey Kong Country, and there's even a ROM hack that restores the original color palette. The screen crunch honestly isn't that much of an issue since they bothered to resize everything correctly, unlike some games ported to this console. The name of the game here is Replay Value, so again, if you've played through the SNES version a million times but haven't tried this one, you might like it. If you want a complete list of differences, Greenalink made a nearly 2-hour video going over pretty much everything. Please give it a watch, because that channel's videos on version differences are practically unparalleled in terms of how detailed they are. Okay, all this talk about enemies has got me thinking about how many of these things are actually in the entire game. Donkey Kong Country does get a lot of mileage out of reusing the same few enemy types between most of its levels, like having different colors of bees or kremlings, but when seeing a full list of them, I was actually surprised at how many there were. The information in this section was put together by my friend Dom, who was the one I mentioned at the start that suggested making this video in the first place. I'll put a card linking to his channel in the corner, the Manglenator12, so without further ado, here is the complete list of enemies in DKC1. Ground enemies make up nearly 18% of the creatures you'll encounter in this game. This section doesn't include Kremlings since they have their own category. We have 98 Naughties, 18 Naughties and Millstones, 58 Slippas, 33 Armadillo Boys, and 18 Mankey Kongs. 225 in total. Next up, flying enemies, coming in at just under 29%. There are really only two types of enemies in this batch, vultures and bees. For vultures, we have 109 Nekis, 11 nut-throwing Nekis, and 26 mini Nekis. For bees, or rather wasps, I guess, we have a whopping 217 zingers, easily the most numerous enemy in the game. Of course, they are split up among four different types, 53 yellow zingers, 31 pink, 113 orange, and 20 green. Object enemies is kind of a weird category, being made up of mostly hazards and obstacles and such. Of them, we have 37 drummies, which are the little enemy spawner things in various levels. We also have 37 flaming drums, 81 mincers, and 9 broken down minecarts. The most common of the aquatic enemies is bite size, with 50 in total. We also have 15 chomps and 15 chomps juniors. Makes you wonder why they bothered creating two slightly different shark enemies. There are 20 different croctopus in this game, 11 clambo, and 19 squidge. And finally, we have the kremlings. With 376 in total, they are the largest enemy group, just barely beating out the flying enemies. There are 190 critters, making them the second most common enemy next to zingers. Like Zingers, they're also split into a bunch of different subtypes. There are 52 green critters, 72 blue ones, 23 purple, 19 gold, and 22 black. We also have 29 clumps, 18 crushes, 6 super crushes, 13 crashes, 74 claptraps, and 28 rock crocs. In total, this adds up to a whopping 1,258 enemies. Thanks again to Dom for counting all of these. He did this all without the help of websites like DKC Atlas. I was actually the one who showed him this site, which he did use later to verify that his numbers were accurate, but still. A few more facts before the next section. Of the 1,258 enemies in this game, 20 of them only appear in bonus rooms, and 10 of them are spawned by the 5th world boss, Dumdrum. Even if you don't count Dumdrum though, World 5 still has the most enemies of any world in this game, housing just over 23% of them. It also has the level with the most enemies, Poison Pond, which has 79 enemies in it alone. Alright, fair warning, but this next fact might ruin your perception of Donkey Kong himself. Once you realize this, it'll become impossible not to see it, so feel free to skip this section if you want. For a few years now, my stepbrother and I have made a habit of pointing out Donkey Kong's retractable teeth. Sounds weird, right? I'm sure you've seen it before. When Donkey Kong has his mouth wide open, he usually won't have any teeth showing, but when he's smiling, they magically appear out of nowhere. Now, we first noticed this in Smash, probably because it's more obvious that in certain animations he either will or won't have teeth. Donkey Kong's design in Smash is clearly modeled after the one made by Rare, which was first used in Donkey Kong Country. Before this, the ape we all know looked much different. The thing is though, I was barely able to find a single piece of official art showing Donkey Kong's teeth that was made when Rare was still owned by Nintendo. The only ones I could find was this image of Donkey Kong Racing and this image of Donkey Kong Coconut Crackers, both of which were shown off at E3 2001, but ended up being cancelled due to Microsoft buying Rare. Not to worry though, since Donkey Kong Coconut Crackers was reworked into It's Mr. Pants for the Game Boy Advance. It really just sounds like I'm making up games right now. Oh yeah, and how could I forget DK's artwork from the original Smash Bros? This was the earliest piece of art I could actually find for this design, which showed his teeth. Now this makes me wonder, was Donkey Kong having teeth something that came from Smash, of all things? Or rather, was Donkey Kong being toothless an intentional part of his redesign? Like, originally I thought that maybe they didn't give him teeth because it was too difficult to do in these early 3D renders, but from the exact same game, Funky Kong has teeth. Actually, Funky Kong is like the exact opposite of Donkey Kong because I think every single render of him shows his teeth. Now, you don't exactly have to be Albert Einstein to realize that Funky Kong is just Donkey Kong's model but with different clothes on, so it makes sense to give him teeth to further differentiate the two. I don't have all the answers, man, but I do know that I'm reading way too deeply into this, so let's just move on. Have you ever noticed that King K. Rool's chest plate is meant to look like a gorilla's? Not like Donkey Kong, but like an actual real-life gorilla. Gorillas kinda have like a huge gut, just like K. Rool, and it's easiest to see when they're standing upright. As we've already established, Donkey Kong is not proportioned like a real gorilla. Speaking of real-life gorillas though, it's well known that Rare initially went to a local zoo to study how the gorillas moved, but they ended up not being satisfied, reasoning that real gorilla movements just wouldn't have worked well in a fast-paced platformer. I don't think they completely got rid of the idea, since Donkey Kong's hand slap is a thing that real gorillas do. Though Donkey Kong does have a few animations that are still in the game, but went unused. They're pretty self-explanatory. You can basically tell what they would have been used for just by looking at them. Hey look, it's basically one of his win animations in Smash. I do want to draw attention to two of them. This kick animation would go on to be used in Donkey Kong 64, but I would have loved to actually see it used in this game. Donkey Kong kicking instead of rolling might have looked dumb when attacking multiple enemies, but that just makes me want it even more. There's also this short turnaround animation for when Donkey Kong's underwater. Diddy has this too, but both were cut out. In the final game, when you're underwater, you just instantly turn with no unique animation. I guess the theme of this section is just things that real-life apes can't do because, as you might have guessed, real gorillas can't swim. A magazine ad for the Game Boy Advance version even pokes fun at this. However, something discovered by cutting room floor user West might point to this being more than just a funny ad. First, listen to this unused bubbling sound effect. There are also two unused Kong sound effects, the lower one being meant for Donkey Kong and the higher one being meant for Diddy. Now, for a long time it wasn't known what these sound effects would have been used for, but their proximity to this bubbling sound might have indicated that the Kong sound effects were supposed to be gulping, and that there was supposed to be an air bubble system in place, much like Sonic. Related to this, Donkey Kong exhales bubbles when he's underwater. It's only Donkey Kong who does this, by the way. This isn't exactly a hidden piece of knowledge or anything, but it's weird that none of the other Kongs do this. Although I guess it's also weird that Donkey Kong himself is only playable in one out of the three Donkey Kong Country games. Now, this point would be where I segue into talking about Donkey Kong Country 2, but this video is already getting pretty long. So for now, I think I'm gonna end off here. Don't worry, I'm still gonna talk about DKC 2 and 3 in the future, though they might not be as long as this vid. Donkey Kong Country 3's section might also be a little shorter than the other two, since I don't have as many memories with it, so I might even lump it together with Donkey Kong Country 2. Who knows, we'll cross that bridge when we get there. I also have other non-Donkey Kong videos planned, so if anything here has interested you, definitely hit that subscribe button. 2021 is the 40th anniversary of the Donkey Kong series, so who knows, maybe Nintendo will announce something Donkey Kong related that'll give me even more to talk about here. Until next time though, goodbye.